Hello and welcome back to Lisa Loves. Today I have a story for you about a young lady by the name of Kelly Bordeaux, who tragically lost her life on the 14th of April 2012 at the very young age of 23 years old. There were three main suspects in this case and one very determined private investigator that was determined to get to the bottom of what happened to Kelly. So let's start at the beginning. Let's tell you a little bit about Kelly. Kelly was born on the 27th of December 1988 in the town of St. Cloud in Florida. She was a very, very popular young girl. She was a cheerleader, she was a beauty queen, and she was very much liked by anyone that knew her, and she was never short of male suitors. A very popular, very beautiful young woman. When she was still relatively young, she met a young man called Michael Bordeaux, and they hit it off. They were very, very happy together, and they decided at a very young age to actually get married. Now, the families weren't overly sure, not because they didn't like Michael, but they were very young. They thought they maybe could have waited a bit longer, but they were determined. So they got married, settled down, and by all accounts, they were very, very happy. They were proving everyone wrong. Kelly then finds her calling and decides she wants to enlist in the military. Michael is not very happy about this. The idea of Kelly being away from home for long periods of time, and the idea of obviously the danger involved and the chances of losing her, he is very concerned, very worried. But seeing how determined and enthusiastic and happy Kelly is with the thought of this being her future, Michael very much supports and goes along with Kelly's desire to join the military. So after her basic training and boot camp, she decides that she wants to enlist as a medic within the army, and she is stationed in Fort Bragg in Fayetteville. Apologies if that is the incorrect pronunciation. So with Kelly now settled in Fort Bragg, her husband Michael moves there to be with her to settle to start the family life. Things unfortunately don't go very well for the young couple. It has been said the stress of obviously relocating to a new state. Michael really struggled with finding work and wasn't successful in finding employment. And it has been said that he drank a little bit too much, and Kelly decided at some stage that she'd had enough of the relationship. But she put it to Michael that they would have a trial separation, and he moved back to their hometown of St. Cloud in Florida. Unbeknown to Michael though, Kelly had actually already moved on. She had met and had been seeing a secret boyfriend by the name of Justin Thompson. She'd been seeing him for a year, and she did actually meet him in St. Cloud in Florida before she actually was stationed in Fort Bragg. So for Kelly, the relationship with Michael was very much over. I'm not sure if this was a case of maybe trying to let him down gently, or maybe him getting accustomed to the idea of them not being together. But for Michael, he thought that they were going to work on the marriage, and for Kelly, very much the marriage was in the past, and she was concentrating on her relationship with Justin. So it was on one of Justin's visits on a weekend to see Kelly that they end up in a local bar by the name of Froggy Bottoms. Now, there was a young gentleman there by the name of Nick Holbert who was quite enamoured with Kelly. He worked at Froggy Bottoms Bar. She was there with her boyfriend, but it doesn't seem Nick was deterred from giving Kelly his telephone number. He was very much enamoured with her. Now, I'm not sure if Kelly was aware of Nick's feelings for her, but she very much, right from the get-go, saw Nick as a drinking buddy. She saw the whole thing as friendship. Obviously, her boyfriend Justin didn't live with her there in Fort Bragg, and this was someone local that she could go out and have a few drinks with, socialise with. She was possibly lonely. She didn't have anyone else there from home. But Nick really saw it as a lot more than that. He was enamoured with Kelly right from the start. So the following Friday night, just a week after she'd been there and met Nick for the first time with her boyfriend Justin, Nick actually invites Kelly out to Froggy Bottoms Bar for a drink, for a pals, a sort of like get together is what Kelly feels this is. Now, Kelly very much would not drink and drive, and Nick offers to drive her home afterwards, and she jumps straight at the chance for a night out, a bit of fun, and obviously she's going to get home safely. And for Kelly, this was very much just a pal's night out. It was nothing more than that. Her boyfriend Justin, however, did not trust Nick, and he told her, when she told him she was going for a drink with Nick, Justin was very much, be careful, I don't trust that guy, I don't like him, there's something in his eyes and I think he wants a bit more than friendship. But Kelly, possibly against her better judgment, I don't know, she decides to go ahead and meet Nick for a drink. So as you may have guessed, after this evening, after this Friday night, Kelly is never actually seen alive again. So on that evening that Kelly went to the bar with Nick, Her boyfriend Justin actually receives like a goodnight text from her that says, "Got home safe, I'm going to bed, call me tomorrow." Now, he thought this was very, very strange because he'd had texts from her previous in the evening, and the last text that he'd received from her had said, "Hey, call me, call me, call me." And obviously now to get a text to say, "I'm home, I'm going to bed," he usually would chat to her before bed, so this was unusual. So he did what any boyfriend would do. He picked up the phone and he called her, and he continuously called Kelly's mobile to no response, which again, this was not like Kelly. He was very concerned, so much so that he actually got in contact with Kelly's family, with her parents, and said, "You know, she's gone out for a drink with this guy. I don't trust him. I'm unsure about him. And she's not answering her phone. And the text that she sent, it just doesn't sound right." And everybody is searching for Kelly. Everybody's phoning different places. Everybody's trying to track her down, to no avail. But obviously this is an adult, and this is an adult that's relocated. This is something that they can't go to the police with immediately. But on Monday, now obviously this happened on the Friday, on Monday when she doesn't actually turn up for duty to the actual Fort Bragg on the Monday morning, people realise something is actually definitely wrong. Kelly took her position in the military extremely seriously, and for her not to turn up for duty on that Monday morning, they realised that something was very badly wrong, and a missing persons report was logged with the police at that stage. So a massive search ensues for Kelly, and obviously right there in the middle is Justin, Kelly's boyfriend, as you would expect, but also from St. Cloud in Florida, quite the long way, her estranged husband Michael turns up for the search, and also the last person to see Kelly alive, Nick, turns up for the search. Now at this stage for the police, these are very much our three main suspects, and actually suspect number one is Michael, Kelly's estranged husband. Obviously she has a new partner. This is something that they think he may have discovered, he may not be best pleased about, but Michael can actually provide a verified alibi for that evening to prove that he was indeed hundreds of miles away in his hometown at the time. So Michael can be ruled out of the inquiry very quickly. And we have to think it must have been quite the shock for Michael. Obviously, his estranged wife and someone that he felt that, you know, he still had much love for and was going to get back together with, to sort of start to miss him for them to get back together. And not only has he found out that she's been murdered, he's also found out that she moved on long ago and was happy with her new boyfriend Justin. So this can't have been easy for Michael, so you have to feel for him also in the situation. So now we move on to the most dogged private investigator we've ever seen, by the name of David Marshburn. Now this private investigator was sat at home watching telly, and he was watching various interviews that were taken with different people that were involved with Kelly's search, and Nick was actually one of the people, obviously the guy that had last been with Kelly. And as David sat and watched him be interviewed on telly, he said, "I'm like a human lie detector. I immediately knew that this guy was lying, and I was completely determined that I was going to prove that it was him and that I was going to solve this case." Now what David usually did is find people that had gone on the run. That was the main thing that he did. And he said it was all very well and easy to find people that had gone on the run, but he wanted to find Kelly. He wanted to find someone that it was pretty clear at this stage was staying still, and he was determined to bring her back to her family and to bring the person responsible to justice. So David starts investigation into Nick, and he very soon uncovers that Nick is a convicted sex offender. So upon investigation into Nick, David finds out that he was a convicted sex offender who had assaulted and beat a 5-year-old girl when he was 16 years old. It had been said by other people that Nick was a predator to females of any age. He just had an unhealthy interest in females, just above and beyond what would be normal. And he lived in a truck he was a drifter. He lived in his truck in a makeshift camp behind Froggy Bottoms. And given that this is where Kelly was last seen by anyone else other than Nick, this again made David all the more suspicious. The police did look into Nick he basically said that he dropped Kelly off close to her home, and then the text that her boyfriend Justin received was proof that she had indeed got home and that she'd been dropped off and that Nick was not responsible. But a lot of people were very suspicious. Nick was one of those people that just, it made you suspicious. But Unfortunately, they couldn't find any evidence to tie Nick to Kelly's disappearance, any evidence of any wrongdoing on his part, but what they did manage to do was realise that he hadn't registered in that town as a sex offender, so that is an actual crime that's punishable by a year in prison. So Nick was sent to prison for a year for not registering in that town as a sex offender. So while Nick is in prison, the private investigator David he's putting in hundreds of hours of his own time unpaid to try to find Kelly. He's searching in woods, in lakes, in rivers, and unfortunately he turns up no sign of her whatsoever. And he has to come up with a new plan. He's not going to be beaten by this. So he decides that when Nick comes out of prison, he's actually going to befriend him, and he is going to, by hook or by crook, get that information from Nick and find out what happened to Kelly for real. So I just want to read you something here, just so I can get the quotes right from David when he was talking about his plan with Nick. He said, "I had to be his best friend. I had to be a good friend to him. I go within several days, and when he answers the door, said, 'Nick, I'm David Marshburn. I'm a PI and I don't believe that you had anything to do with I don't believe you done it,' is what he said. I told him right out of the gate, 'But I believe you can help me clear your name and find her.' I had it in three stages. You didn't have nothing to do with it. You might have had something to do with it. You did it. By the end of the 'you did it' stage, I was accusing him of doing it and he wouldn't deny it." So that was David's plan. He was determined to win Nick's trust and eventually have him admit that he was responsible and lead him to the body. So David's plan, because he knew Nick was down on his luck financially, he basically bought his friendship. He lent him money a lot, he bought him cigarettes, he said he would be out for dinner with his own family and Nick would call him and say, "Look, I need to borrow money." And he would leave dinner with his family and travel sometimes hours to wherever Nick was to lend him that money, to sort of get that basis of trust with him. But months were going by and he was no closer to getting any information from Nick, and David was getting very frustrated, and he actually admits in an interview, "To be honest, I just wanted to take him to a barn somewhere and start cutting his fingers off to get the information from him, because I knew he was responsible but he wasn't giving anything up." So the next ploy that David tries with Nick is to convince him that he has managed with his prosecutors to work out a plea deal for Nick. And if he admits being responsible and he leads them to Kelly's body, that he will get, in return for this, treatment for mental health, not incarceration in standard prison, and he will go to something that resembles an apartment complex, and he will have access to computers and education. And Nick reads and rereads and rereads this plea deal, and for David it's all the proof, the concrete proof he needs that his suspicions definitely are true, are founded, that if Nick is sitting reading this and seriously considering signing the document, then he must be responsible. Why else would he consider signing a plea deal? But unfortunately, right at the last minute, after having read and reread the document, Nick says, "No, I'm not going to sign this, because once I do, they'll just take everything back anyway." So 2 months have passed. David is just, he's getting nowhere, he's got nothing from Nick, even though he knows for sure that Nick's responsible. So the next thing that David does is he manages to convince Nick that he's about to be indicted for Kelly's murder. Now they must have something, they must have some evidence, they've got something on Nick. And the reason David does this is because in his work as a private investigator, he said, "Hell, I found it difficult to understand the wording and the jargon in most indictments, so I knew that Nick would struggle also." He manages to put a bondsman outside Nick's address. He manages to convince him that he's about to be brought in, he's about to be indicted for this case. So David shows Nick the fake indictment, and obviously there's a bondsman outside his address in a Crown Victoria. And when he sees the Crown Vic, he's like, "They're coming for me, they've got something." And all of a sudden, Nick is suddenly ready to sign that plea agreement that David had offered to him earlier. This is when Nick actually admits to David that yes, he is responsible for Kelly's murder. And David puts his hand on Nick's shoulder and says, "So, are you ready to tell me? Are you ready to lead me to where Kelly is buried?" To which Nick said, "Yeah, he's ready to take him." And a few hours later at the crime scene, Nick fully confesses everything to police detective Jeff Locklear at the scene. His exact words were, "I was on top of her and she just started screaming." What they go on to discover is that They had had a normal evening in the bar, but Callie had not been paying Nick the attention that Nick wanted. She'd been playing pool, they'd sung karaoke, she'd been flirting with other guys. The people said just being friendly. He used the word flirting. The end of the evening comes and Nick said she started acting funny with me around when she went to pay her tab. The reason for this is because when she went to pay her tab, the bartender actually said to her, "You do realise that that guy is a convicted sex offender? Please be careful." Now Kelly had no idea, she didn't know this. Nick is waiting for Kelly at the car outside to take her home, and she's having none of it. She walks past him and the car and continues walking down the road. And he shouts after, "Hey, I thought I was giving you a lift home." And rather colourfully, I won't give you the exact language, Kelly shouts back, "F you, you effing child molester." And Nick, just enraged, runs up to her and hits her over the back of the head and knocks her out cold. What further happens is that Nick goes on to rape Kelly and she must come to when this is happening and she starts screaming. Nick's first thought is, "I need to shut her up." So he picks up a large rock that's lying nearby and he callously beats Kelly over the head with it until she's dead. He tells the police that he wrapped her head in a trash bag, obviously to prevent as much evidence as being left at the scene as possible, and he takes her away and he buries her in a shallow grave. That shallow grave is very close to where he lives at the back of Froggy Bottom, so she was not very far away that entire time, and he leads David, the private investigator, and the police to that shallow grave where they dig, and they do indeed discover Kelly's remains in the grave. Nick also admitted that he had used Kelly's phone to send a message to Justin to say that she was home safe when he knew that she was dead, and he actually, after he had killed and buried Kelly, he had the audacity to go back into the bar and spend the evening there, which is where he sent that text from, and then he disposed of Kelly's phone in a nearby river afterwards. So this massive 2-year journey that David Marshburn, that private investigator, had been on, determined to find Kelly to bring her home to her folks who had no idea what happened to her. He got very emotional when Kelly's body was uncovered. It had been a long journey and one that he was determined to reach the conclusion of. And he said himself that he teared up and he just said, "You're going home now, baby girl." And I found that very, very moving. That family, to have had that private investigator, to have put all that hard work into finding Kelly, it's just remarkable. And Kelly's family themselves have said, obviously they're extremely thankful, and the police have said, and the family have said, that they wouldn't have found what happened to Kelly without David, because the police will quite rightly admit, now they are sort of confined within certain elements of the law, and there are things that David did that the police would not be able to do, that if they did, a case would be thrown out. So they admit that David was instrumental. It was down to him that we find out what happened to Kelly. Nick went to court and obviously pled guilty to first degree murder and was sentenced to life in prison without the possibility of parole. Nick actually had the audacity to try to apologise to the family in court. Obviously, it wasn't something they wanted to hear. Kelly's mother made him look at her while she just told him exactly what she thought and asked him why. Why would you do this? Now, there were two siblings also, Matt and Olivia, and Matt did really fear that he was going to do something terrible in court if he had to sit in the same room as Nick. And I completely understand his feelings in that. I struggle with how people can remain so composed when being in the same room with someone that has so callously murdered one of your loved ones. And Matt did end up having to be removed from the courtroom for being too vocal. He said the fact that he didn't get up and do something to Nick, he says it's just as well that the judge had me removed because, you know, that's what I wanted to do, that's what I may have done. And I can completely understand his viewpoints. So that is the story of Kelly Bordeaux, a really promising young army medic that had her life in front of her, a beautiful, young, intelligent young woman, a full life to lead that was callously snuffed out by this predator, no other word for it. So thank you for listening to Kelly's story. Thank you for watching. If there is any cases you would like me to cover, obviously feel free to put them in the comments. And I look forward to speaking to you next time. Over and out from Lisa Loves.